So we're going to move into the part where you got to listen to me. So if you need more coffee or need a more snack, feel free to get up and go. But we do, joking aside, want to make myeloma simple. This is a series that we've actually commenced through this program and now have built into our website. You can see, again, you're stuck with seeing me, but we've done a whole series of videos, or ultimately planning to do over 30 of them, where we can break down the complexity of science and make it straightforward. And that's really my objective over the next few minutes, is to make myeloma simple. There are people here today that have myeloma. There are people here today that have had myeloma for many years, perhaps not 28 years as Yelich, but many of you have had myeloma for a long time. Other people came in really not knowing how to spell or what myeloma means. And so we want to provide an opportunity to understand that a little bit better together today. So I really go back to the very basics, right? I'm a hematologist, so we're a little bit obsessed with blood, not the Halloween obsession with blood, but our own interest in blood. And blood really is an organ, and it flows through our body, of course. And to keep it simple, the blood has two bits. There's the solid bit and the liquid bit. The liquid bit we call the plasma, and the solid bit are the cells. And we have three cells that circulate in our blood, and I try to make it easy here by calling them red, white, and rosé. red, white, and platelets. And so red cells are just little red trucks that carry oxygen. So they come to my lungs, they pick up the oxygen I breathed in, they go deliver them to the tissues, drop it off, and come back for more. I know I'm offending the hematologists in the crowd, but that's pretty much all red cells do. By contrast, white cells, which we're going to get into a little bit more, they're kind of like your army. They're like soldiers in the army. In fact, we have five kinds of white cells, like we have five branches of the military, and they're there to protect you. And we're going to be talking a lot more. Dr. Zonder is going to share a little bit of what we do with what are called T cells. It's remarkable. It's almost like watching an episode of Star Trek or some kind of science fiction movie when he's going to tell you what we can do with these cells. But white cells are what help protect you, and more than ever do we understand the significance of infections and the need for protection. And then the third kind of cell, platelets, I jokingly call the rosé cells, are just little cells that help you clot. I call them like an ambulance, because they get there first, they patch up the problem. So if I cut myself, the platelets get there, they plug it up, and then they make a phone call, as it were, to the emergency department or to your clotting factors that come along and form the full blood clot. Now, all of these cells are made in what's called the bone marrow, which is the factory of our blood. So on the one hand, we have our bone marrow that's making blood. The other hand, well, what is cancer? I mean, if someone just asks you in the street, what is cancer? I try to simplify it to three words. It's uncontrolled growth, but really, as you can see here, as I describe it, it's not just uncontrolled growth, it's identical uncontrolled growth. What I mean by that is that we should be grow. Sometimes we're growing in the wrong places, but naturally in our lives we grow, right? And that's good, that we want that turnover of our cells. But cancer means that there's a clump of cells somehow that are essentially identical, and they start growing, and they grow out of the usual proportion that we should. It's just easier to conceptually think of a lump of cells in a breast, or in a lung, or in a colon. But myeloma, as we're going to be describing today, is going to be a challenge for us to initially understand, because it's a cancer, but it's a cancer of cells that live in that bone marrow, that are in the factory. So it's not so much a lumpy tumor as you tend to think of, but it's still the same concept of a group of cells that are growing a little bit out of control. And sometimes we call it the double whammy, because these are the very cells that are meant to protect you. So myeloma is a cancer of what's called the plasma cell. It's different than the liquid plasma I talked about earlier. Makes it a bit confusing because we use the word plasma twice. But these are cells that live in your bone marrow that are really important. You may not know this, but during the whole pandemic, you were talking about plasma cells all the time, even if you didn't know it. Because these are the cells that make antibodies. So if I give my good friend here in the front row a vaccine, and that vaccine is for whether it's the flu, measles, mumps, rubella, COVID, what happens there? We send a signal to the body, and specifically to the bone marrow, and specifically to the plasma cell, to say, hey, plasma cell, this is what COVID looks like. Please make an antibody, or make something that can attack COVID if COVID makes it into the system. And so that antibody or against body is designed to go against, whether it's, or for my Canadian friends or for those from Northern Michigan, against, the flu, the COVID, whatever it else might be. So plasma cells are really important. I've sometimes joked about, you know, how I would love a picture of my wife's plasma cells to put next to the bed, you know, because I love her and I love her plasma cells. Yeah, I know I'm a total geek, right? But no, trust me, I have a picture of my wife. If you saw my wife, you'd want to see her picture too. She's beautiful. But we love plasma cells, and we don't, on a regular basis, appreciate how important plasma cells are because they make our antibodies. But what happens in myeloma is that now all of a sudden the plasma cells are cancerous. What's cancer? Identical, uncontrolled growth. So now these plasma cells, instead of making good antibodies that fight measles, mumps, rubella, you know, tetanus, the COVID, the flu, now they make a bad antibody. Sometimes we call it a monoclonal because it's identical, or an M protein or an M antibody. And now these bad antibodies do the very opposite. So instead of protecting you against infection, they go and attack your kidneys, and they attack your bones. And they grow so much in the bone marrow that you're not making the good antibodies. So you're at risk of getting an infection. And these are all the downstream effects that happens to a patient who has multiple myeloma because of those abnormal plasma cells. And to be clear, this is different than melanoma. Someone reached out to me last night and said, my doctor just diagnosed me with melanoma. Should I be coming to see you? I'm like, well, I'd be happy to see you, but I don't know much about melanoma. So melanoma is the skin cancer. Myeloma is the blood cancer, right? So they're very different phenomena. So when you think of myeloma in general, and I'm going to get into the natural history a little bit, it's not a very common cancer. It accounts for about 2% of all cancers. So we have about 36,000 diagnoses expected in 2023. And tragically, about 13,000 people will die from myeloma this year. On one hand, that sounds awful. On the other hand, thankfully, we're seeing huge improvements. Back in the days when, I'm going to pick on Jeff Zonder because he's of my era, but back in the day when we started in myeloma, when many of our residents and fellows weren't even in utero yet, you know, I went into myeloma because I wanted to care for the sickest of the sick. And I worked at a myeloma clinic back in Canada where I trained, where most of our patients didn't live for a year. And this is back in the time, roughly at the same time that Yelich was diagnosed. And sometimes they would live 2 years. And inevitably, if you went to the myeloma clinic, most of our patients were hunched over waiting in the waiting room because we didn't have the bone strengthening drugs that we have now or the treatments we have now. Most patients had fractures in their back. It was terrible. Myeloma is still a terrible disease. Trust me, I've committed my life to fighting this hideous beast. But we've made massive improvements. And Jeff is going to share, Dr. Saunders is going to share in a few minutes a little bit more about some of those improvements. But now the average survival of patients continues to grow such that for most patients, in my clinic next week, when they come to see us, I can tell them that we expect our patients to live more than a decade compared to what it was not that long ago. And for many, as you heard from Yelich, it's even longer than that. We're going to get into more details of what I have here on the slide, but myeloma is twice as common if you are of African descent. And, you know, often we use, you'll see today, we use sometimes the word African-American, sometimes the word black, and sometimes people say, well, are those absolutely synonymous? And I have an example to show you, which is me, right? So I'm African-American, but if you looked at me, you wouldn't think I was black. And so what I mean by that is my origin is within Africa, but there are areas within Africa where people typically are not considered to be black. On the other hand, there are people who are black in this country who may not, if you will, identify or associate themselves as having come from Africa. So we use the words, not exactly synonymous, there's a lot of overlap between them, and that's one of the reasons why you'll see why we make nuances of using both of those words. But genetically speaking, for those who have an origin in Africa, we do know that we're at twice as risk of getting the disease, meaning that it's twice as common to have the disease within that community. In fact, as I'll share with you in a moment, 20% of all patients in this country are of African descent. Next slide, please. And so part of the challenge of myeloma is that the diagnosis can be challenging. And you can bring up the percentages across the bottom. You know, patients don't come into the clinic with a sign on their head that says, "Hi, I have myeloma." Right? You know, and again, I make light of a serious situation, but very often when it comes to breast cancer, someone might feel a lump or it gets detected on mammography, or someone comes in with a colon challenge because maybe they see blood in their stool and so on. It's a bit more subtle with myeloma. People come in with fatigue, with bone pain, in particular often in the back, or if they do get a blood test, remember those red cells, the little red trucks that carry oxygen? They're anemic. And I gave a talk this past week to 250 primary care doctors, you know, who say to me, "Dr. Joe, like, we see fatigue, back pain, and anemia every single day in the clinic. Most of those people don't have myeloma. How do we figure out which one has myeloma and which doesn't?" Well, we'll come back to that later. Thank you for asking that question, because that's part of the IMPOWER project, to educate primary care. But this is part of the challenge, is that, as we're going to see today, one of the greatest reasons for the health disparity or the inequity that we see in myeloma is that often the diagnosis is delayed in any patient who has myeloma. Sometimes, occasionally, it gets picked up because someone has a routine blood test or an insurance blood test that gets picked up. Most people, it takes 6 months before the diagnosis is made. The average patient sees their primary care doctor 3 times with signs and symptoms consistent with myeloma before the diagnosis is made. If you're African American, if you're Hispanic American, unfortunately, you have to tack on another 6 months in general before that diagnosis is made. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. Next slide, please. And so I'm not going to go into much detail here because I know Dr. Saunders is going to cover it as well, but we've typically called the myeloma symptoms the crab symptoms. That's how we remember things. You know, back in the days of medical school, we had an acronym for everything and anything. My study partner was a hockey-obsessed individual, so most of our acronyms in our study group were something like, we had hockey stick, we had rink, we had arena, we had like all these things. That's how we remembered certain diseases. We remember myeloma. You know, you are allowed to laugh at some point. At some point, I'm going to try and get you to smile today. Although you gave Pastor Johnson the best smile of the day, so I'm happy with that. But we call it crab, and we call it crab because the 4 sort of cardinal symptoms or signs of myeloma is a calcium elevation, so that's where the bone is leaching out this calcium because it's being attacked by these bad cells. Renal or kidney damage, anemia or the low red blood cell count, as we've talked about, and then indeed the bone disease. We've added a few others to it that we now call slim crab, but for time purposes, I'm not going to go into great detail about this right now. And so one of the things that becomes important is, although we're focusing today on myeloma, I just want to make a quick comment that if we look carefully enough, even though I said myeloma is pretty rare, right? 2% of all cancers, you know, 36,000 new cases this year, there is what we call a precondition where someone can have just a tiny bit of this abnormal protein in their blood. So the plasma cells in the bone marrow, they've really not gone off the rails. They just make a little bit of schmutz of this bad protein. That's incredibly common. In fact, 5% of people over the age of 40 have that. That's 1 in 20 people, if I look for it. Now, I'm not trying to scare anybody about it, right? But what I'm saying is that is extremely common. Thankfully, for most of those people, it'll always just stay a tiny little bit, as we tell patients, like dust in the corner. It's there, but we don't need to do anything about it. But a fraction of those patients will go on to develop something in the middle we call smoldering myeloma, where there is more of the disease, but maybe not quite at a stage we need to treat it. There are still some people smoldering myeloma who will never be treated, and then it becomes active myeloma. And this is an important concept that we want to have a lot of time to talk about today, but this idea of trying to detect the disease early. The lingo right now in the cancer world is we use the word intercept. Right? We want to intercept cancer early. And this may give us a hint down the line. We're doing some work to try and find out, should we be screening for myeloma, for example, especially in higher risk populations? We're not quite there yet, but it's something that we're going to think about over time. All right, my last couple of slides on this just remind us that, and Jeff is going to talk about this more, that thankfully with all these great new treatments we have, we can get just about every single patient we treat into some kind of what we call remission. Now, remission does not equal cure. Remission just means we've put the disease asleep. But unfortunately, at some point, the disease is going to wake up again. And what we've learned over time is that the disease keeps waking up. If we keep developing new treatments and drugs, that's good. We can control it. You know, we don't cure diabetes. We don't cure high blood pressure. We control it for the long term. And we're hoping to have that same modality of myeloma as we work, of course, towards a cure. The challenge is over time, this disease can become very challenging to control. Because every time it comes back just a little bit stronger, just a little bit stronger. And so it becomes really important that we develop good treatment to really put this thing to sleep and to put it to sleep for a long time. When I talk about these treatments, now this slide is purposely meant to overwhelm you, not only because of all the colors, but because of the words on it. If I were giving this talk back when Dr. Zonder and I were in medical school, this would be really easy because we would have had one, maybe two words on this slide. But we have developed all these different classes of drugs. You can go to the next slide, please. There's even more. And there's more coming. And so I also want to make sure that today is not just a dreary day where we say we have this incurable cancer with terrible outcomes and terrible health inequities. We're here to empower ourselves to change that. And it is changing. And we want you to be a part of that as we see that we have more and more opportunity. We're going to hear, unfortunately, that some of these great treatments are less accessible to African-American patients or Hispanic-American patients or patients that live in rural areas. But we want to work ever so hard to make sure that we overcome that health inequity.